Hello, ladies and gents. We are about to do some economic analysis between three countries. Those three countries are USA, Singapore, and the world average. I'm using them because lately the Heritage Economic Freedom Index, which is a bunch of different parameters that measure how well one country is performing, I believe, against another, can reveal why Singapore lately is thriving and America is having problems in comparison to the rest of the world. What we might want to do to learn from both Hong Kong, probably the freest, most prosperous per capita country, at least with the new population as opposed to old money, compared to, let's say, the USA. So Hong Kong would have been a good model as well. Okay, so here's how it goes. This chart goes back in time from 1995. Now I'm using the overall score. From 1995 here to 2008, not too hard to understand. This is a chart. This is some sort of a relative rating. And as you can see, it does not go down to zero. So it's perhaps skewed in that results. So let's just talk about this. The yellow line is Singapore. The gray line is USA. The lavender line is world average. As a matter of fact, if we took a USA and Singapore out of it, the rest of the world might be lower than this. So now we're going to go to specifically what factors make up the overall score and what we need to think about when we understand and compare countries for solutions to the future. And models that seem to be successful. Let's talk about the first category, property rights. Now, property rights is the degree that you own what you've bought, and you can continue to own that, and without corruption or protection by government, no one could confiscate your property more or less. And we could see here, let's go to the present, let's not even compare the past. We could easily see here that the USA is currently at 79%, more or less. And this reveals, when compared to Singapore, that Singapore has even more respect for property rights than the USA. Is this one of the reasons it's doing better? Worthy question there. Let's go on to the next thing, judicial effectiveness. How corrupt is your government? How good are they at following the law and order and following due process? And here we could see, although this chart does not go back prior to 2017, that currently USA is 77%, 76.9, and Singapore still is outperforming us. This is once again perhaps a little revealing. Is it disappointing? You could think about it. But look, when compared to the rest of the world, which also includes Singapore and the USA, yeah, we're doing pretty good. So this would be, this basically is something that the public can look at and say, well, is our government doing is our law system doing the best it can? And can it be better? Who is better? What are they doing that we're not doing? That's a great question. Now, here is government integrity. I believe that has to do with corruption, how the political parties handle these things. So, if your government is corrupt and a one of these, what do they call it? Third world government, anyway, this reveals that. And here we see, once again, Singapore, 91%. They have a more ethical government, I would say. And not by a little bit. This is a 20% difference nearly between the USA at 72% almost. We should be able to do better. This kind of means that maybe we should be cleaning the swamp in Washington at the minimum compared to the world. Now, there's the argument that says, oh, but look at the rest of the world. Aren't you glad to be in America? I don't buy that argument, because just because, you know, half the class is failing doesn't mean I don't wish to get the best score or consider myself independent. What is the best I can do? So to say, oh, but aren't you glad you live in America compared to North Korea? That's not a sufficient answer logically. So I'll dismiss that. But yet it is a good comparison. Let's talk about tax burden. Now, tax burden has to do with the amount of taxes your government charges both corporations, businesses, and individuals. And this is a kind of measure, I guess, of efficiency. That's important to account for once again. By the way, I may have screwed up. The world is, let's just see. Oh no, I'm right. Wow, look at that. The tax burden in USA is pretty, now this doesn't mean a 65, we only waste 65% of our money. This is a positive score. In other words, how good, how ethical, how sound is the tax burden? So USA has a higher tax burden than purple, being the world average, and certainly Singapore. Now the question is, if government is taking money from the cash registers of Walmart and Starbucks, what are they spending it on? Well, ultimately that money, if left in the cash register, metaphorically speaking, of the businesses that generated that money, they very often know how to invest that money or give it to their shareholders far better than a politician. So we would say that this basically is diversion of our tax prosperity by the government, perhaps in a parasitic way, to do what they want. And this is pretty revealing. Singapore, nice score, Singapore there. Okay, now let's talk about government spending, which kind of sounds like it's related to tax burden, a little bit different here. The government spending has to do with how much it spends that might be considered frivolous on certain programs, and we can question those. We might say that's for welfare or military industrial complex or the educational industrial complex, where the government's par with, side up with the universities and educational systems and become one and colluded as a kind of a government spending incest with these corporations. Here, once again, let's look at some numbers. The government spending in the USA and Singapore, well, that's a good score, 90.6. USA, once again, man, oh man, we got a lot to work on. We're really low here. Certainly not the lowest, don't get that wrong, but we're at 56.5. We should do a lot better. Here's the world at 64.9. I don't even want to compare ourselves to the world. When I hire a doctor, I want the best doctor. I'm not thinking about, oh, what about all the quack surgeons I could have got? So this is a very important number to bear in mind. Let's talk about physical health. Now, that has to do with how much of a debt and deficit your government probably has. And we could look up, and I invite you to look this up on heritage.org and or Wikipedia, where it explains these things even deeper. This is supposed to be superficial and probably, yes. So we'll leave it at that. So that is the amount of how, just like a family that cannot manage their money, they're always going into debt and spending beyond their means. So here we see Singapore. Decent score, 80%. So they're not, they're not playing too many games with their money. The world, well, the world average we see is nothing to brag about, but still, that's far better than the USA here at 54.8%. This is embarrassing, Uncle Sam. Let's go to business freedom. business freedom is possibly the amount of time and permits and bribes a business might have to do to start or get start or to expand. And so this explains why a country may have more businesses giving more jobs in one region, one country versus another. So let's look at the scores. We know America is certainly not the worst. Here's USA. Our business freedom score, remember this is a score, is 82.7. Not too bad. Singapore, 90.9. Now look at this. Singapore was once much higher in the year 2009. The question is Singapore slowly going downhill like ancient Rome and many countries seem to make this mistake? We have to ask ourselves that question. In any event, Singapore score is 90.9, USA is 82.7, world is 64.8. And this may explain why one country has more jobs than another. Let's talk about labor freedom. Labor freedom would be the amount of steps you have to go through to hire an employee. Well, in the USA, we actually penalize employers by creating a tax, an additional tax on that business or corporation, provided it's a certain size, for every job they create. I say this is ass backwards. We shouldn't punish our corporations and businesses for hiring labor. We should reward them and use them as examples. In any case, the United States is not doing too bad. The United States and Singapore are very close to about 91 to 92. Okay, kind of nice. And maybe we should compare some abysmal countries on this chart next time just to see how low the low have fallen. And you may want to put in the blog which countries you want on the YouTube blog you want me to compare next time for you. But in any case, the USA does have more freedom of labor to hire labor. And by the way, this also has to do with unions imposing false regulations and obligations, I believe, on employers. So world, catch up here. Now let's go to monetary freedom. Monetary freedom has to do with how much regulations and meddling with Treasury and the Federal Reserve Bank or central bank if a country does have one. And here we could see that manipulation of money, some call it monetary printing, monetary policy, is Singapore still higher than the rest of the world. One time it used to be beautiful, approximately 2003. So there is this obvious trend. Maybe China would be interesting to put on this list too for the fun of it. And once again, we have USA at 78.6. And then we have the global average close to 76.8. Okay, well, there's no reason we can't, you know, be much higher. Is there a problem with 99% score? Maybe that's what we should ascribe to. That should be our goal. Trade freedom. Okay. How many tariffs, how many restrictions, how many laws do you have against trade, both probably international and within your country or state? And here, we do not see that much of a horrible difference, but Singapore, once again, is higher at 90% compared to the USA, 86. I don't know about you, but which would you rather have as a score on any test or measurement? I'd say 90 beats 86.7 anytime. Give me the higher score. Investment freedom. Well, what can you invest in? What is the protection of your investments? I'd have to look that up a little bit more. Does it have to do with Now, inflation probably is probably monetary freedom there. So investment freedom would be how many regulations do you have? Do you have laws against monopolies or trusts, collusions and other things? And we could say, are these laws good for the politicians? Are they bad for the businesses? Are they good for the consumers? We'd have to talk about that. So investment freedom, let's just go to the last measure, financial freedom. Well, financial freedom has to do, well, let's look that up. Let's look that up. I have that, I believe, right here. And trade freedom, financial freedom indicates banking efficiency and how independent the government is from the bank. Okay, very, very good. So I think I was right about monetary freedom being how stable prices are. In other words, inflation is known to be a government-created malady. So we could see the distinction between monetary freedom and financial freedom. Financial freedom talks about how much is the banks colluding, and that also includes Wall Street with government. And I say that's a kind of collusion that's very typical of fascist Italy. It was a kind of collusion, and even fascist Germany, collusion of private capital interest with the government. It's sort of like this. The government is looking for a handout and bribe, saying, we'll put you out of business unless you follow the government agenda. The banks or financial firms are saying, how much can we pay you for the next election to get a 5% reserve, a capital ratio for banks, a matter of law? So these things are worthy of studying and analyzing. And I will leave it at that.